This is a day the Lord hath made, and I will So last week we talked about the resurrection. To my dismay, there were many churches who did not talk about the resurrection last week, which I'm a little shocked at. But I do want to say this. The reason the church meets on Sunday and not Saturday is because of the resurrection. We celebrate the resurrection every week. And we should celebrate the resurrection every day. The resurrection is what makes the difference. And so this morning, I'm going to talk about why the resurrection still matters. The resurrection is just as important this Sunday as it was last Sunday. Last Sunday was a celebration of the event, but the truth is, so is this Sunday, and so will next Sunday. Jesus is alive. He is not dead. And so here's some of my thoughts this week. What is the gospel? Okay. What is the good news? Jesus is alive. He died for our sins. He rose from the dead. I want to break it down a little bit more this morning of what the gospel is. And I hope you're taking notes, because if you're here this morning and you've never accepted Christ as Lord and Savior, I pray that today through the message, the Holy Spirit will spurn you and cause you to want to accept Christ as Lord. But for those of you who are born again, I want you to take notes, because the biggest weakness in the church today in America is our inability or unwillingness to share the gospel. It's our unwillingness to witness, to testify. It's like there's kind of a several fold thing going on here. One thing is the gospel's been saturated in America, so we feel like everybody's heard the gospel. But I want to tell you, there are people in America who have not heard the gospel. But even if they have heard the gospel, there are the way in the majority of people in America have not accepted the gospel. So just because they've heard it don't mean we quit sharing it. We need to keep sharing it. You never know when that day is going to be that somebody is ready, that somebody is ripe. God has done things to prepare their hearts to get them into that place. And so the church in America as a whole is very weak about praying with people. Man, when you see somebody in Walmart and you can tell they're hurting, what should you do? You should pray for them. When you go out to eat, ask the waitress if there's anything you can. You'd be surprised. You'd be amazed what some of them might tell you. And you have these encounters every single day. So when we ask ourselves, what is the gospel? I thought of four questions. And I think these four questions surrounded the gospel for the last 2,000 years. The first one is, who made us and whom are we accountable to? Who made us and who are we? Now, for you guys, if you're already born again, that's an easy question for you to answer. But the world doesn't. The biggest attack in our culture is on creation. Amen. Why do you think that is? Because if you admit that there's a creator, then you realize you're accountable to that creator. Amen. So what does the world come up with? The world comes up with the Big Bang Theory, evolution, so that there's nobody to be accountable to. We're all just here by coincidence. We were just blown into existence by some explosion that happened, and all this order came out of that explosion. That is the stupidest thing I've ever heard of in my life. But part of the gospel is, who made us and who are we accountable to? And we need to relay that to people who we encounter. What is our problem? What is God's solution to our problem? And how can I be included in the solution? And here's the answers that Christians have given throughout the centuries. Number one, who are we accountable to? We are accountable to an almighty God. Number two, our problem is sin against that same almighty God. And number three, God's solution is salvation through Christ Jesus. And number four, we come to be included in that salvation by faith and repentance. Isn't that good? That's the gospel in a nutshell. And we all need to know that, and we all need to be able to share that. We need to be able to look for those moments when people are ripe, when they are ready to receive. And even if they're not ripe and ready to receive, it's still a good time to plant a seed. There's never not a good time in the kingdom of God not to plant a seed. Come on, we ought to be planting seeds every day. Romans chapter 1, verse 16, Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. Does anybody in here know what's on the sign on this side, out front? On the sign. That's good, Roy. That's a new one. But on the sign, on this side, what does it say? The gospel is the power of God unto salvation. Amen. It's been there for about 6 years. And as far as I'm concerned, it can stay there till Jesus comes back. Amen. There's no more important message than the gospel is the power of God unto salvation. So why does the resurrection matter to us today? Romans 8:11 says this. If the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who lives in you. What is that saying? We sing it. The same spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. That should matter. That's why I asked earlier, what do you believe? What do you believe today and what will you believe tomorrow? Because see, it's not just about what your mental assumptions are. You can profess good things mentally but not believe them. You can know them intellectually but not know them internally. You can say on Sunday when you're surrounded by, you know, a lot of people are chameleons. Have you ever noticed that? It just depends on who they're with. If they're with church people, it's hallelujah, glory to God. But on Monday through Saturday, it's blankety blank, blankety blank, blankety blank. They don't line up, do they? No. See, if you're a Christian, if you've been born again, then your life should be a resemblance of what you profess to be. Like I said earlier, the number one reason for atheism is for people who claim to know Christ, but their lifestyle shows they don't. Who wants to believe in that? That's hypocrisy. Everybody hates that. Everybody hates Pharisees. It's about knowing him and your life resembling that. It's not about perfection. Nobody this side of heaven will ever be perfect. There's only been one perfect man, and that was Jesus himself. But us, as believers, even though we are not perfect, our lifestyle should resemble what we say we believe. What we say we believe should be acted out in our lives every single day. Doesn't make us perfect. We still gonna make mistakes. But our lifestyle shows that we live what we say we believe. Amen? Amen. Now, I'm gonna ask you again. Do you believe the same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you? Amen. Okay, you believe it today, but will you believe it tomorrow? Will you believe it Friday? Because that's a long way off. Will you believe it when you're by yourself and there's no one around and the enemy's attacking you and he's whispering things in your ear? Do you still believe the same power that... See, that's the test. That's the test of where you're at spiritually with God. What do you believe when you're alone, when it's hard, when things aren't going your way, when your husband dies? See, Tina's proven her faith right now. She is spending time in the Word. She's listening to God. She's in meditation. She's really seriously seeking the Lord. That's proof of your salvation. And I can't imagine any day being any rougher for Tina than what she's going through right now. But in the midst of her most biggest trial, she is seeking the Lord. Her lifestyle is proof that she believes, that she lives what she says she believes. The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in us. Amen. Man, that was weak. Is it because I said it so low? The same spirit that raised Christ from the dead lives in you. Yeah. Much better response.
I'm not shaming the devil.
Romans chapter 6. We're going to start in verse 5. And remember, we're talking about what does the resurrection mean to me? I want you to listen to this. This is, again, it's still Paul. Paul said, if we have been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. Amen. So there's a couple things about the resurrection I want you to understand. There is a resurrection we're looking forward to, right? There is a resurrection, but there is also resurrection power that is here right now today. No matter what we're going through, no matter what we're experiencing, resurrection power is available to every single person who's put their faith and trust in Christ. Amen. Verse 6, for we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. Listen, here's what being born again and living in resurrection power breaks the hold that sin has in our lives. Now, do we still sin? But when we do sin, why do we sin? It's not because the power of sin has a hold on us. We're still free will agents. We still get to choose. You can choose to join in with your buddies at work when they're cussing like sailors. You can still lust after women if all your buddies at work are lusting after women. You have the choice. But the power of sin does not have a hold on a believer. If you sin, it's going to be because you willfully chose to go against what you knew was right. The power of sin has been, somebody ought to get happy about that. The power of sin has been broken. Before you get born again, you don't have an option. You're a slave to sin. It's only after you come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ that the power of sin is broken in your life. Verse 7, because anyone who has died has been freed from sin. Oh, come on, that'll preach. Are you dead this morning or are you alive? You better be dead. You better be dead to your flesh, but alive in Christ Jesus. You better be both, right? We have chosen to crucify our old man, that sinful nature. That's how you grow and mature as a Christian. You make the choice to crucify your sinful nature. Because anyone who has died has been freed from sin. One person got happy about that. Who was that? Thank you, Gil. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. Jesus will never die. Okay, I got one for you. If you've been born once, you're going to die twice. If you've been born twice, you're only going to die once. Somebody ought to write that down. That's good. If you've been born once, you're going to die twice. And what I mean by that is if you've only been born a natural birth, then you're going to die at the end of this life, but you're also going to die eternally. But if you've been born twice, if you've been born naturally and you've been born again by the Spirit, then you're only going to die once. We're going to have a natural death, but we will never die. What does your bulletin say? Somebody give me a bulletin. Front page of a bulletin. I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. Whoever lives by believing in me will never die. You believe that? Mercy. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. Who's that? That's us. See, the death he died. He died to sin once for all. When you get born again, you make a choice to die to sin, to die to your sinful nature. Therefore, verse 12, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. See, once you make a choice, you'd be surprised sometimes what your choices do. When you make a choice to sin, what you're really doing is you're letting some spirit have control of your life. You don't want to do that. Because when it gets a hold of you, it'll pull you in. It'll suck you in. What is the purpose of Satan trying to get us to sin? He wants to kill us. He wants to destroy us. He can't do it unless we let him. So therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, because if you do, then you will obey its evil desires. So do not do that, right? Verse 13, do not offer the parts of your body to sin as instruments of wickedness, but rather offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer the parts of your body to him as instruments of righteousness. For sin shall not be your master, because you are not under the law, but you're under grace. Somebody ought to say hallelujah for God's grace. My next question was, do Christians have any power? Do you believe in your life as a Christian, do you have power? I'm only going to give you a few verses that talk about power that Christians have. Acts 1:8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. What's he talking about? When you get born again, you receive power. When you allow the Holy Spirit to live and operate in your life, you receive power, the power of the Holy Spirit. What is the purpose of that power? I think when you read Scripture, the main purpose of that power is so that we will have the power to be witnesses wherever we go. Why are we not witnessing? Do we not have power? Or are we just not working in that power? There may be people who think they do. What is the number one reason for atheism? People who claim to be Christians, but their lifestyle says they're not. God help you if that's you. And you can change that today. You can fully commit your life to Christ and change that, so that the same power that raised Jesus from the dead now lives in you. And then we won't have why do we not witness? Are we afraid? 365 times in the Bible says, do not fear. That's one for every day. There is no reason for us to fear. Why are we not witnessing? Why are we not sharing our faith? Is it because we're afraid? If we're afraid, we need to deal with that. Because the Bible says if you're born again and you've been filled with the Spirit of God, you have power. And there is absolutely no reason for you to be afraid. People ought to be afraid of you. People ought to be afraid of us. When we walk into a room, unbelievers ought to fear us. Believers should be overwhelmed and overjoyed to be with other believers. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Is there a demon in hell that can stand to a human being who has been born again, who has the same power that raised Jesus from the dead living in them?
No.
What are we afraid of? We ought to be casting out demons everywhere we go.
Amen.
They ought to be afraid of us. Somebody should have got excited about that. Hebrews 4:12. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing of soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. I think that's a pretty good reason to get to know what's in here. And don't be afraid to use it when you're witnessing. What are you doing? You're at the very least, you're planting seeds. Did you hear what it said? It penetrates even to the dividing of soul and spirit. James chapter 5, verse 16. James said, therefore, Confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. Amen. Listen to this. The prayer of a righteous man is powerful and effective. You have power. And I think the greatest thing the church has missed in terms of power in America is what happens when we pray. How many prayer meetings are called every week by churches and nobody shows up? And why is that? It's because we don't see the essence of prayer. We don't see the power in prayer. I'm telling you, the closer I get to Jesus in my life, the more I don't want to go anywhere, talk to anybody, or do anything without praying first. Because the truth is, the spiritual realm is more important than the physical realm. And I think everything that happens in the physical realm happened in the spiritual realm first. Where do you want to live? I mean, there's a essence here where we're stuck in the physical realm, but we don't have to live here. We can live in the spiritual realm. Somebody ought to get happy. Amen. Ephesians chapter 6, Paul says, verse 10, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Amen. Part of our problem is we try to walk around in our own strength. Yes. We don't need to be walking around in our own strength. We need to be walking in the power of God. Yes. Have you got enough scriptures to prove that you have the power of God in you so far this morning? Amen. 1 Corinthians 1, 18, Paul says, listen, for the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. Amen. Don't be afraid to preach the cross. It may sound foolish to those who don't believe, but you are at the very least, again, you're planting a seed. Because we know different. We know it is the power of God in our lives. Amen? 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6. Paul again says, for this reason, I remind you to fan into flame the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity or fear, but a spirit of power and of love and of self-discipline. Sometimes we need to be encouraged to fan the flame that God has already put in us. If you've been born again, you have already been given gifts. You already have callings on your life. You may not understand all of what that means yet. You may not understand all of your giftings. You may not understand your callings. But from the moment you've been born again, you have been gifted. And sometimes we need to encourage each other. Sometimes we need to fan the flame and say, go get them, Cindy. You got this. You know what I mean? Encourage each other. Encourage yourself. Fan the flame of the gifts that God has already given you. All right, so I'm going to end with this. What keeps us from walking in the power of the resurrection? And I'm not saying this is a all-in-all list, but this is what came to me. The first thing that keeps us from walking in the power of the resurrection is sin. When we choose to sin, we allow the enemy to trap us and hold us back. Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And John, but look at what John 14:30 says. Jesus is speaking. He said, I will not speak with you much longer, for the prince of this world is coming. Who's that? Satan himself is coming. But look what Jesus says. He has no hold on me. Amen. And I'm telling you, when we walk in the Spirit, he has no hold on us. Amen. The only way he can get a hold on us is if we willfully choose to walk in the flesh and let him trap us. But sin has no hold on us as a believer. The second reason I think that we don't walk in the power of the resurrection is ignorance. Hello. Biblical illiteracy is rampant in America. Hosea 4:6 says, my people are destroyed from what? Lack of knowledge. We have to have knowledge. 2 Corinthians 10, Paul said, for though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. Let me give you an example. On Monday, you go to work and one of your coworkers slaps you in the face. What's your response? Flesh. Flesh. The flesh says, I'm going to slap them back. What does the Spirit of God say? Are we going to walk in the Spirit or are we going to walk in the flesh? Listen, we don't wage war as the world does. We're either going to fight our battles in the spiritual realm or we're going to fight them in the natural realm. And if you fight them in the natural realm, I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to get your butt kicked. But if you fight it in the spiritual realm, you're going to win. That's where the power is. The weapons that we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power. What kind of power? Divine power to do what? Now, do you want to demolish strongholds or do you want to get entangled with strongholds? Because the way you choose to fight is what's going to determine whether you win or lose. Look at verse 5. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. Now, how are you doing with that? How are you doing with taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ? If your first response when you are slapped is to slap back, you're not taking every thought captive. If your first response is to always respond to the flesh, you are not taking every thought captive. The enemy, I believe every believer has a demonic assignment. Now, we also have guardian angels. We get the Holy Spirit living. There's nothing to be afraid of. But I also believe every believer has demonic assignments. And those demonic assignments are whispering in your left ear. Listen, they have no control, no authority, no power over you whatsoever unless you give it to them. They're whispering in your left ear. Your guardian angels and the Holy Spirit's whispering in your right ear. What determines how you respond is which voice you listen to. God could make us obey Him, but He doesn't do that. He respects our free will so much. It's probably the thing He treasures the greatest among us. He respects our free will, so He will not force Himself on you. And the cool thing is, Satan has to play by the same rules. So Satan, you hear somebody say, the devil made me do it? That's a lie. The devil can't make you do anything. Now, he can whisper in your ear, and you can choose to believe him, and you can choose to obey him, or you can choose to listen to God and obey God. But Satan has no power, no control, no authority over you whatsoever unless you give it to him. The third reason I think that we don't walk in the resurrection power is out of fear. And again, I'm going to read 2 Timothy 1:7. We just read that a while ago. What does it say? For God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. We have not been given a spirit of fear as a believer from God. If we're experiencing fear, it's because we're still living in the flesh realm, not living in the spiritual realm. And we're not being obedient to God. Listen, we're human beings. There are certain things that can scare us, but we choose whether or not we're going to walk in fear. When the Israel army was facing Goliath and he's coming out there every day, there's 40,000 men in the Israeli army, and every single one of them feared Goliath. And here comes a teenage boy who's not big as a minute going against a guy that's 9'6" tall. This guy's equipment weighed more than David did. But the difference between David and those 40,000 Israeli soldiers is David had a relationship with God. Amen. And God had already proven himself to David. How many of y'all have already killed a bear and a lion? Now, living in Texas, it's kind of hard for us to even get to experience that because as far as I know, there's no lions. The only chance we got to run across a lion is if one breaks out of a zoo. And really, there's not many bears in Texas either, and there's certainly none right here around where, so we're probably not going to get that opportunity. But I'm telling you, every day in our lives, there are things that happen. There are things that come up that seem to us to be as big as a lion or as big as a bear. And if we have that relationship with God, and God has already proven himself to us, when the lion and the bear show up, we're going to go after it. We're not going to run from it. Hello? Are you with me? Because God has already proven him. Now, God doesn't start out with lions and bears. He starts out with little things. The more you trust him with the little things, the more he's going to give you bigger things. And the more you trust him in the bigger things, pretty soon you get to the place. I mean, David lived all of his life as a shepherd. So listen, he's isolated. He's out there with sheep all his life. He doesn't get human interaction. So who's he talking to? He's talking to God. And by talking to God, he develops this relationship with him. The more he develops this relationship, the more trust he has. You know what our problem is today? We spend way too much time with people. We spend way too much time with noise. We spend very little alone time. Where I'm telling you, everybody needs that. I want to encourage everybody this week to write Tina, send Tina a card this week. And don't put nothing stupid in there. Well-meaning Christians say the stupidest things. Tell her you love her, you're here for her, you're praying for her, but you know, be careful about saying anything that would make it worse. Encourage her. Write her a note. Why did I say that? There's a reason why that came out right there. Huh? So what she's doing this week is she's spending that time alone with God. She's seeking God. She's listening to him. She's in his word. She desperately wants to hear from him. And I'm telling you, we don't need to wait till a crisis comes in our life. And I'm telling you, she didn't. Because if she waited till a crisis, she wouldn't be doing it. And it's the same way with you. If you wait till a crisis comes, then you probably won't even do it in the crisis. We need to be doing it on a daily basis. So when Goliath shows up, and we're all going to have Goliath show up in our life from time to time, when Goliath shows up, we're ready. Amen. We already have built that faith and trust in God. And Goliath, instead of looking at Goliath being 9'6" and bigger than me, I look at Goliath and say he's 9'6". He ain't nothing compared to God. He may be big to me, but he's not big to God. So whose perspective are we going to lean on? Listen, this is true every day in our life. Are we going to lean on our perspective, or are we going to lean on God's perspective? Name somebody that's bigger than God. Go ahead, I dare you. And the last one would be unbelief. Mark 9:23 says, Jesus said, if you can, everything is possible for him who believes. Underline that. Think about that just a minute. Some things are possible for those that believe. It didn't say some things. Everything is possible for him that believes. So where's your belief at this morning? How strong is your belief? Everything is possible for him who believes. Immediately, the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. I'm going to tell you, that's a great prayer for all of us. Because no matter what level our belief is, there's still room for improvement. And so we ought to pray the same thing. Yes, Lord, I believe. Help me with my unbelief. Help me in those places where I'm weak, where I'm not yet there. Help me overcome that. 2 Timothy 3:5 says, having a form of godliness but denying its power, have nothing to do with them. Now think about that just a minute. Who are you hanging out with? Listen, this is even for church people. Who are you hanging out with? If you're hanging out with people, like we talked about earlier, who have a form of godliness but denying its power, you better get away from them. Because they are influencing you more than you're influencing them. Jesus said, have nothing to do with them, but live a life that not only has a form of godliness, but we count on the power thereof. See, that's a godly life. A godly life is we recognize the power of God at work in us and through us. Why? Because we know that the same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives in us. Amen. Y'all seem to like it when I inflectuate my voice. Is that what? I'm going to end with this. John 14:11. Jesus said, believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves. I tell you the truth, anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these. Do I need to read that again? I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these because I am going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Son may bring glory to the Father. You may ask me for anything in my name and I will do it. Are we doing greater things than Jesus? Now, at first glance, we want to read that and we want to say, I can't do greater things than Jesus. Jesus was the Son of God. Listen, Jesus was limited by his own choice. He was limited. We are not limited. Jesus never left a radius of more than 50 miles from where he was born. And still, he changed the world. But you and I have the same Spirit of God in us that he had. And we can go anywhere. We can do anything. The only thing that holds us back is our unbelief. When you feel led to witness to somebody and you don't do it, why did you not do it? Is it because you didn't have the power? Is it because you were fearful? Listen, I'm not getting on to you. Everybody starts out as baby believers. But as we continue to walk with the Lord, our faith should increase. Our faith, our boldness should grow. And so when you blow it, that should stick in your mind. And you should pray about and seek God, why did I blow it? What happened there? And correct that so that I promise you, you'll get another test. God does not kick us out because we fail. He just lets us retake the test. And you're going to keep retaking the test until you get it right. And so if you refuse to seek God and find out why you failed, then you will get to keep taking that test over and over and over again until you decide you've had enough of it. Can I encourage you just go ahead and repent and get it right the first time? It makes life so much more simpler. And if we knew the power of God that was available to us and that how much God wanted to use us, it would excite us. Listen, God wants to change the world as much today as he did 2,000 years ago. In fact, he's been steadily changing the world for 2,000 years. And how does he do it? He's always done it the same way. He changes the world one heart at a time. See, sometimes we say, who am I? I'm just a little podunk Christian in a podunk church in Texas. What can I do, really? I'm telling you, Jesus can use you to change the world. And even if you don't get to change the world, you get to change the life of every person you touch when you touch it with the power of God. Now, do you believe it? Do you believe the same power that raised Jesus from the dead lives in you? Will you believe it Friday? Will you believe it Saturday? Because see, the test is not how you answer me. The test is how you do Monday through Saturday. Because opportunities are going to come up. Things are going to happen. And you get to decide every single time, what am I going to do? Am I going to live in the power of the Holy Spirit? Or am I going to trust my flesh nature? Listen, let me tell you, our default is always to trust the flesh nature. But there's no power in that. There's only death in that. It takes boldness and courage to trust God, to trust the power of the Holy Spirit that's living inside of you. But I'm telling you, if you will grow, if you will begin to trust, and you will begin to use that same power that raised Jesus from the dead that lives in you, you begin to tap into that, into your everyday life. Not only will it turn your world upside down and change your life, but it will change the lives of all of those you come into contact with. How many of y'all believe it this morning? So when I say the resurrection is just as meaningful this week as it was last week, I mean it. Jesus means it. It's important every day of the week. We celebrate every time we come together on Sundays because that's the day he rose. But we celebrate because that power of that resurrection should change the way we live. Let it never be said of me and let it never be said of you that there was no power in our life. Let it never be said that we always chose to default to the flesh nature. Let it be said of us that we were those who believed and moved and acted on our belief. That our lifestyles reflected our belief in the cross and in the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
May the Lord bless you and keep you and be gracious to you. May He grant to you the peace that passes all understanding. May He draw you closer to Himself and prepare you for His soon return. Amen.